the story we like to tell ourselves to almost feel better about our circumstances is that anyone who then does have a lot of money must have done something corrupt to get it, you know? And it's so important to unlearn that.
What's up, y'all? Welcome back to the Breaking Bread Podcast. This is interview one, episode two. I'm joined here today by somebody that I call a brother, a friend, a phenomenal storyteller. For me, he's a when I think of a creative entrepreneur, like, he is that, right? I think he represents everything that he preaches on his social media and out in the world. So I'm joined here today with my brother, William Tyrone Toms. Yeah, I'm going to drop your government on you, bro.
That's cool.
AKA Will. So welcome to the show, Will.
Hey, thank you, Nas. Man, I'm excited to be here, bro. Like you said, man, you're someone I really consider a brother, a close friend. So this is fun. Let's get into it.
Yeah, absolutely. And, like, it was a no-brainer. Like, when I thought of this platform and I created this, I was like, yo, I got to have Will on here. Like, it was just, you know, it was going to happen.
I appreciate that.
But, Will, kick us off. Like, who is Will Toms? Like, tell the people who you are.
Yeah, you know, I can answer that many ways, but, you know, in short, I'm Will Toms. I am, you know, 30-year-old creative entrepreneur, you know, someone who's always been extremely passionate about the intersection of culture and commerce, right? Like, where does art, media, and all that stuff intersect with making money? I'm a nerd and very passionate about that. I'm someone who, you know, loves his people. A lot of the work that I do, whether it's in entrepreneurship or outside of that, is really centered on empowering people of color to be able to advance themselves, mostly through figuring out how we can make money, but also do that with integrity and really figure out how to get paid to be ourselves. So the business that I built, you know, to be able to uphold that is a company that is called Rec Philly. Really, the company's called Rec, Resources for Every Creator. And in Philly, they call us Rec Philly. And essentially, I built a creative agency and creative space that connects creative people to all the tools, the resources, the strategies, and the community that they need to build sustainable and scalable businesses around their passion. So that's like the short version of it. But again, I'm, you know, 30-year-old entrepreneur from Philadelphia, from the Germantown section of the city, you know, which informs, you know, I think my worldview in so many ways. You know, and beyond that, man, I'm just a young person out here trying to get it, you know?
Yeah. Yes, sir. that was a I'm just gonna call you on. That was a very humble way to announce yourself, but I think of you more, but I appreciate you nonetheless.
I mean, you know, I could name some of the accolades and things like that too.
Yeah,
you
drop
know.
Them, bro, because like I think it's important for people to understand who they listening to right now.
Okay, fine. So, you know, the business that I mentioned of Rec has really changed my life in so many ways and changed the lives of a lot of the members we serve. And one of those ways is, you know, in doing that, I have been able to earn myself a spot on the Forbes 30 Under 30 list. I was named Forbes 30 Under 30 in 2021, which was a blessing. I snuck in right there before turning 30, which was great. You know, I've also, you know, built a multi-million dollar business with my best friend from high school, which is really special to me, you know, and for folks who want to build something around people they care about and want to be around, you know, and do something meaningful. You know, hopefully folks can take away from my story. But yeah, I built a multi-million dollar business and growing, you know, before the age of 30. I've, you know, put myself in the space to get awards like Forbes, like, you know, my company is the 40th fastest growing business in our city of Philadelphia, which is dope. You know, I have over 20 full-time employees. You know, I did my first TED Talk last year, which was really dope. I am an author. I have my first book about to be released in the next few months. So yeah,
make
so
sure
there,
grab,
there's some
make
other
make sure you
things.
Grab that book. Make sure you
yes.
grab that book.
Make sure you grab that book. You know, it's right here. I gotta keep that thing on me. But we'll talk Ooh. About that later. You know what I'm saying? We out here.
So you said something, right? So on this show, we really try to take, you know, the creative entrepreneurs and the athletes and their stories, right, regarding their relationship with money, right? So something you said that stuck out to me a few moments ago, but you talked about being paid to be yourself. And one of the biggest things, like personally, that I've learned from you, right, is that you are a walking commodity and you need to operate in that, from that space, in that vein, right? So could you talk to people a little bit about what did you mean by, you know, being able to get paid to be yourself?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, for me, like, I learned really early that, you know, most people walk through life trading their time for money, you know, because it's real out here. So people got to eat, people got families to feed. So growing up, I saw a lot of people around me that would live a lifestyle where they'd work a 9-to-5 and they'd work really hard. Some people work in multiple jobs, right? And coming home, living for the weekends. You know what I mean? Like, not really enjoying what it is they're doing, but doing it just because it's paying the bills. Or even worse, you know, you have an experience like what I had was, you know, I went into the corporate America world and it was cool. I had a good job and I actually enjoyed the work. However, I felt like I had to, you know, give up a piece of myself as soon as I walked into the building. Right. I had to put the face on, you know, but some of us understand what I'm talking about. You got to put the face on, voice change a little bit. You code switching now with the best of them because you feel that as a survival tactic, you got to walk in that space and show up other than your truest self because you have to deal with the perceptions of the people around you. You want to disarm them and make them feel safe in the space. So you got to give up a little bit of who you are. Right. And to me, that wasn't a life that I wanted for myself. It was, could I find a way to do well financially, but as my whole self and really like getting paid to do the things that I would have been doing even if I wasn't getting paid to do it? Is there a way for us to do that? And, you know, I feel like luckily because of the time period that we're in, we have that opportunity. You know, there's people who are getting online and they're playing video games because that's their passion. That's who they are. They love that stuff. Now they're earning hundreds of thousands of dollars on YouTube and on Twitch, literally doing the thing that they would have been doing for free, right? And that can be in so many different examples of, hey, I'm on Instagram, so I like to make cooking videos. Boom, I can make cooking videos and make a living because I understand the strategies to do so. So a lot of my work is about that. How do we show people that, like, you don't got to make that sacrifice, you know, and do the song and dance to try to fit into a box that wasn't even designed for you in the first place? You can think about what are my unique skills and gifts and passions, and if I can be intentional about understanding digital strategy and these platforms that are at our disposal, I could be able to make a meaningful living through that passion of mine.
Damn, I'm like processing all of that, right? I know I'm the host of the show, but like I'm like processing that because I'm like over here taking notes too, like dropping, you know, as you dropping these gems. But like, so let's start early, right? Let's start early on in life, right? Let's start at the origin, right? You talked about trading time for money. I think we had to be the shift that we wanted to see in the culture, right? Because we all grew up with parents and grandparents that, you know, working a 9-to-5 and securing a good job and getting a pension or a 401k, that was the, you know, that was the holy grail. So like growing up, what did that look like in your household? Like the examples that you had in front of you, like, you know, kind of talk to us about, you know, what that looked like.
Yeah, man, it's interesting, right? Because like, you know, in a certain regard, you know, there's folks who grew up and their parents maybe had, you know, retirement plans, 401ks, pensions and all that stuff. And maybe we're talking to them over the dinner table and having those conversations about managing money and securing assets, buying property that will appreciate and all that stuff. But, you know, the reality for me and I believe a lot of young people from, you know, where I'm from, those aren't the conversations. Right. Like I grew up and I personally wasn't even raised by my parents. You know, my mom, you know, really early, unfortunately, in my life, like, was battling a drug addiction that she had to figure out. And, you know, I grew up watching, you know, the violence in my community. You know, like I had an uncle, you know, at a young age, he was 16, you know, he was murdered. You know, my father and other uncles spent, you know, decades and more in prison. So for me, I was raised by my grandmother who was a hustler, you know, like just figuring it out, working, you know, odd end jobs, just trying to make ends meet, you know what I mean? And doing all that. So for me, it's like growing up watching your grandmother, for example, like, you know, one of her side gigs was like, she used to, and I don't really talk about this often, but like I grew up watching my grandmother just to be able to make enough money for me to go on class trips and be able to just live that normal high school experience. She had a side gig cleaning some of the houses of the teachers that were at my school, right? She was figuring out how she could, you know, create little knickknacks and sell them. And I had another grandmother who was selling platters on the block, you know what I mean? Just to feed the community, but also to make some bread. So like, for me growing up seeing that, it was like, yo, like, they're really breaking their backs to provide just to make ends meet. And early on, I'm like, that's not what I want for myself. Like, I respect the hustle involved, but I'm like, there has to be another way. And then at some point I start to realize, you know, when I moved from the city, I went to a high school right outside the city, just, you know, 20 minutes away. But that opened myself, my brain up to a whole different environment where I'm like, yo, these kids' parents not doing what my grandma's doing to make ends meet. These kids is cool on these, going on these field trips and getting all this bread. So I'm like, why do the people that look like that have all this bread? And why do most of the people I know don't have it? And that really kind of gave me my hunger to want to understand money and economics and how it worked.
So during that time, was there ever a point where you and your grandmom, or, you know, your uncles, or your, you know, both of your grandmoms, did you guys ever sit down and ever talk about money? Like, no. Did you ever talk about how to pay bills, or, you know, none of that? Any of that?
Bro, no. Like, coming up, that just wasn't the combo. Like, you know, money was almost this, like, this thing that it was the elephant in the room at all times. You know what I mean? Like, and for better and for worse, right? Like, one of the things, you know, about my grandmother that I appreciate, and I tell my friends kind of jokingly, is, like, I didn't really know that we was broke for real, until I went to college. You feel me? So, like, I saw the effort and all that, and I saw what was happening, but it didn't really land on me that, like, yo, we really ain't got it, you know, just because of the love that was present in the household. And, like, again, my grandmother went out of her way to make sure that I didn't know what we didn't have. So there was a lot of conversations that I was not privy to, or at least she didn't want to bring me into, because she knew, you know, I've been an old soul my whole life. She knew that if she let me know that we wasn't in a good situation, I was going to find a way. You know what I mean? Even as a young person, as 12, 13, 14, you know,
that's so grandma.
Right? So she tried to kind of hide that a little bit. But then what the conversations eventually did develop, they were all conversations from a place of lack. You know, it was, yo, I'm in college, and, like, yeah, I got this scholarship, but I also want to be able to do these other things. And she's like, listen, I don't got that. When scholarships for me ran out, right, senior year of college, I'm overachieving, doing all this stuff. It was like, yo, I got a hold on my account. I need $6,000 in order to register for classes. She's like, yo, like, we got to figure this out, because it ain't just sitting here in the bank account, for sure, you know? So then we started having those conversations. And then really when the real money conversation started, it was, wait, grandma, I'm about to get this laptop because I'm a video editor now, and I need to get the Mac so I could do real, real dope work. How come my credit ain't working? How come I can't get the credit card to then get the loan? I've never had credit before, so how come my credit is bad now, right? And then we start having conversations around, hey, well, listen, it was bills in your name, it was this. And I share that because I know I'm not the only person who's experienced things like that, but that was like the start of money conversations. It was, how are we going to get out of this hole? How are we going to figure it out, right? It was never a proactive, yo, this is what we're going to do so that way you're never in this situation, right? Like, and I only say that in from a place of love, because she taught me what she knew. But she couldn't teach me what she didn't know. You know what I mean? So when it comes to credit, and, you know, I came up different people claiming me on their taxes, like all that stuff, right? Like, we get real creative around money as Black people. But yeah, man, coming up, man, there wasn't a lot of money conversations at all.
You know, that's really interesting. Cause we all learn, and that was a good point that you brought up, cause, like, you know, for myself growing up, if my mom, my grandma, my dad, anybody you knew that was struggling, like, yo, I'm going to the store, I'm gonna grab some candy, I'm gonna go in the neighborhood selling candy, you know, anything right. to do to try to help them out. So that's sure. I resonate with that part of the story very much so, because I can attest to that. Yeah. So speaking on that, like, stand right there, right? We're gonna stay right at that intersection of your upbringing there. What was one of your first money memories, you know, growing up?
Oh, that's a good one. I two come to my mind as soon as you
okay.
say that.
Give me
Right.
both of them. Give me both of
All
them.
right. So the first one, again, like I mentioned the example of the class trips, because that's a very real memory for me, right? I'll never forget, man. I think still elementary school at that time, and I was in like fifth grade, and the class trip, I think we were just going down to the Franklin Institute. And I used to love the Franklin Institute when I was a kid. I had at this point, I believe I had went once before. I remember going in the heart and all that, if you remember the Franklin Institute. But I remember we were about to go on a class field trip, and I really wanted to go. And it was one of those Johns. I think that Johns like $36. You know what I'm saying? So you could help pay for the bus and whatever else. And I remember having a conversation with my grandmother, and she was like, "Look, like I'm gonna have to see about this next week." And I'm like, wait, but I gotta get the permission slip signed by Wednesday of this week. Like, I can't see about this next week. What you mean? You know, and what she shared with me at that point was this magazine. She was like, look, I can't promise you that we could do this trip, but if you wanna be able to do trips in the future, here's this magazine, and you could find whatever you want in this magazine, and we could be able to figure out a way to build a business for you to be able to make some money. It was an Oriental trading magazine. I don't know if you ever heard of Oriental Trading.
No, what's so yeah, break that
It's
down.
yeah, Oriental Trading. It was this magazine. I don't know if they still make it or not, but my grandmother used to get it all the time. It's a magazine that basically sells little novelty items and stuff, but in bulk, right? So as a kid, I love marbles, right? I'm out here battling kids for marbles. They would sell. I could buy. It was the first time I ever learned what a gross was. I could buy a gross of marbles, which meant that like I could buy 144 marbles. And in my mind, it was like, okay, cool. She's teaching me this. I could grab these marbles. I could go to school. I'm battling kids with these marbles I just bought. You know what I'm saying? I could sell the marbles. So that was my first ever like introduction to like entrepreneurship. You know what I mean? So that was like the first kind of money moment I do remember having. And then later, I remember I had a big 16th birthday party. And, you know, in high school, I was one of the more popular guys. You know what I'm saying? Doing my thing. So I remember I threw, it was at that time where like MTV had like the Super Sweet 16 show or whatever. So everybody was like, yo, I gotta have a crazy 16th birthday party. So I threw a big party, and I'll never forget. People was like, yo, what do you want for your birthday? And I told everybody, I was just give me cash. And I remember I got like three bands, like $3,000, and having all that money for the first time, and like how it felt to like have that. And then that's when I went and I bought a camera for the first time, and I spent over $1,000 directly on just camera equipment and all this stuff. And when I was at the Best Buy register, just putting the cash on the junk and being like, here, like that's a feeling that I'll never forget because I had never felt like that before. Really being able to be like, yo, I could make some moves with this. You feel me?
No, that's dope. But you know what? Something I just pulled out of that part of that story was the reason, like, the direct reflection of like not having money forced our folks to get creative with how we could get money. And then in that process, you were learning some very early principles about entrepreneurship, about hustling, about, you know, trying to use your limited resources now to get more resources. And I think that kind of paralleled you into to rec, which we'll get to. But like, it's so crazy that you had that instilled at a young age. But you know, in those moments, you probably didn't look at it like that. You just looked at it as like, I need to get this bread so I can go on this trip, or, you know, so I
100%.
can, you know,
But
get this camera equipment.
right, but at the same time, underneath it all, she's teaching me, you know, value creation and value add, right? Like, and she's teaching me, like, not in this language at all, but like the arbitrage of buying something in bulk, right? So I can get it cheaper, and then I can go sell that same thing that I paid 30 cents for to somebody for $4. You know what I'm saying? Like, and that's really the core of it all.
Listen, brother, that story is like, I love it. I love it. So here's something I wanna ask, right? What did your fa so the fact that you guys didn't have these discussions early on about money, right? No conversations, whether it was about credit, budgeting, you know, investing, any of these, you know, kind of high level topics. But what did your family model when it did come to money for you, though?
You know, I think some
Whether
of
it
the
was good
things,
or bad, whether it was good or bad, yeah.
some of the things that my grandmother specifically, right, you know, as the head of our household, some of the things that she modeled to me were like, yo, my grandmother was good for like keeping a stash of money somewhere and like almost hiding it from herself. right? Like, that save some cash for a rainy day. That was her, yo. Like, it would be up to a point where she would clean the house one day and like lift up a vase to like clean under it and realize she had some cash stashed under that, right? Like, so there were some savings tactics, right? Almost some out of sight, out of mind, put money away story that developed. Not a story of what I would learn now of don't save, invest, right? Like, so the money can grow. There was none of that, but it was, yo, save for a rainy day. It was, you know, I grew up watching my aunt, you know, she went to college, you know, a couple years ahead of me, and like watching her journey about credit, you know what I mean? And then almost seeing that narrative of, oh, all credit's bad. Don't get a credit card because it's just going to be bad debt and you're going to ruin your life because you got a credit card, right? Like, which is a very one-sided part of that story, right? Credit's actually amazing, you know?
Yes, it is.
But that was another story that I saw modeled in my family. It was like, nah, don't do credit. If you ain't got the cash for it, don't buy it. But it's like, yo, what? So yeah, those were the two that I can kind of just like remember clearly.
Okay. So all right, now, so we're going to bring this story up, right? So we kind of started there in the beginning talking about like some of the upbringing. So, you know, you went to college, right? You're at IUP, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yep.
Talk to us about like what that was like in college. Like, you know, most college students are, let's face it, they're broke. They don't have no money, right? We're waiting on refund checks to come in. We're waiting on, you know, side gigging up there if you're working on campus, all types of things to kind of get some cash flow. I can attest to that myself. Like,
straight
those
up.
Three bands hit the bank account on that refund.
Refund check, yeah. Facts, bro.
I'm on Chegg, you know, getting the used books because it's cheaper. Like, all these different places to kind of, you know, kind of make ends meet. So talk to me about like how did your relationship with money, what did it look like in college? So, you know, you started off, you didn't have those conversations, you got to college, like you said, you realized that you didn't have credit. Now this was another roadblock that was in front of you, when you went to go get your MacBook at the time.
Yeah.
Right? So kind of talk to us about that.
Yeah, man. So like when I got to college and had that challenge, when I went to go get the Mac, that's when we started to have those real conversations around, is there money here? Is there not? You know what I'm saying? And like, what really, what support I could lean on my parents for and what I couldn't, you know? But then, you know, to be honest with you, man, I started turning up in college because that entrepreneurial ability that I was developing slowly stuck. And then on top of that, that like, I've always been a social butterfly, right? So I had friends over here on the football team, but I also had friends at the TV studio, and I'm in a fraternity. So like I had that whole network. So I was very well positioned to be out here making money and hustling with whatever I could do, right? So I was, you know, shooting music videos for people back then and making a couple $100 where I could. And then, you know, I'm not too proud to say now because, you know, legalization is upon us. I was out here, you know, selling weed, you know, trying to make some money and do what I could. And I was very successful. You feel me? So like it got to a point where it shifted where like, you know, I've never really said this in public before, but like it got to a point where I was calling home to just try to get money to a point where I had enough money to send money home. You know, so then the whole dynamic could shift where it was like, you know, like get into spaces where like I go back home and I see my mom who I haven't seen in mad long, you know what I mean? She tried to slip me $20 that I know she ain't really have, where I could be like, nah, and then sneak $100 back to her. You feel me? Like, and that felt good. You know what I mean? To be able to take care of your people in a way, like, you know what I mean? I ain't got to call home ever asking for nothing. Eventually my grandma, I'm like, yo, hold on. You ain't asked me for nothing in months. What's going on? Like, but that happened, and I had the freedom to just be like, all right, I got the freedom to get it, and I'm a thinker, so if you give me enough time, I'm going to make it happen. But that's what college kind of turned into for me. It became the breeding ground of like, all right, you got the time, the freedom. You want to get to it or what?
Sound like a young Diddy to me, right? You by any means necessary, right?
By any means.
Making it happen. I'm sure like a lot of people can resonate with that. Like, it's so many different, like, you know, challenges that come up, like you get in the, have you ever dealt with you went to the financial aid office and they're like, yo, you owe us this, and you're trying to figure out like how the hell that's gonna happen?
Bro, yeah, so that's honestly the start of the story for me. Like,
okay,
for, so All right, real quick. So I never smoked weed or nothing in high school. I was like straight. I was like all about getting my grades and all that stuff. Didn't drink, didn't smoke. If you smoked cigarettes in high school, me, you couldn't even have been friends. You feel me? Like, cause that's just not the energy that I was on.
Right.
But when I went to college, I had an experience where, in short, I'll try to speed this up cause I don't want to spend too much time on it. But, basically I had an internship. I was one of those bulls super early in college. I was already, you know, taking 300 level classes cause I was very focused on like being deep in my major and my minor. So in junior year, I had already lined up a really dope internship. Long story short, at IUP, and I'm sure maybe some this way in some other places, but at IUP, your internship, you needed to basically pay for the amount of credits to cover your internship. So depending on the amount of time you wanted to spend at the internship, you had to pay a certain amount of credit hours to make it happen. I didn't know that, right? I'm like, I'm working for free, so like I could just work here. So I had an amazing internship at NBC Universal. Basically, I had scheduled with them to take a 6-credit internship, so it was X amount of hours. But when I got there, they loved me. So they were like, yo, you can spend as much time here as you want. I said, lit. So I literally was almost working there every single day over the summer. I got back to school, and they're like, hey, how many hours were you working? I told them, and they was like, oh, that wasn't a 6-credit internship. That was a 12-credit internship. So to do that, that means there's still 6 credits you got to pay for that are not covered in your scholarship. So at that point, I forget exactly how much money it was, but it was like $3,000-$4,000 or something like that, or $6,000. And I went to the bursar's office or whatever to like help me figure it out. And they were like, yo, you got to pay this hold. And at IUP, it was like you had a 7-day add drop window. And that's when people could drop classes, you could pick up. If you didn't schedule by then, it was chalk for that semester. So I got to a point where I had less than a week to be able to make somewhere around $6,000. And that put the battery in my back, and I was like, well, I gotta figure this out for school. So long story short, I figured it out. I'll just say that.
It's over. Listen, no, that's all the battery you needed to, you know, to be put in your back, because at that point, that paralleled you into some of where you are today, right? Like, so let's talk about that, right? You graduate college, you go to the corporate America, corporate America space, and you don't have to even mention, you know, the company. Sure. You don't desire, but you go to corporate America. Talk to us about that point where you were like, you might have had this, you were making probably good money at this you know, job. Mm-hmm. You know, why did you give that up? You know, coming from, you know, having nothing, and then now you graduated, and the holy grail again, like I said, you want to interrupt me?
Go ahead. Yeah, I got to interrupt you. So
go ahead.
The crazy part of the story is I didn't graduate.
Oh,
like,
okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I ended up literally getting to my last semester. And those same creative ways of making money ended up coming back and biting me in a way that I ended up having to leave school for a little bit and got to the point where I'm hella depressed, you know. I'm like, everything was about getting this degree and like doing good at school so I create opportunity for myself. So I ended up coming back to Philly for a little bit. But at that time, me and my grandmother had a convo, and she's like, look, like, you're not going to sit up here depressed, like, I get it. You're upset. You're shameful. There's guilt, but like, do your thing. You know what I mean? You got nothing but time right now. And I built my first business in that window when I couldn't go back to school. And what happened was I'm throwing shows and parties and all this. And while I'm throwing all these parties around the city, throwing concerts, I ended up getting recruited to work for the marketing agency that I ended up working full time at. So they saw me, they're like, yo, you're clearly a good marketer. You're filling these rooms and these venues. Let's teach you real digital strategy. And before I even graduated, they gave me that job. So now I'm working for Eminem, Shady Records, Ice Cube, doing amazing work for these artists that I've grown up watching, right?
Right.
But then it got to a point, and this is to answer your question, where one, I'm there at my desk, you know, 8 to 5, and for half the hours, I'm now thinking about my business that I'm trying to build, knowing that I'm going to leave here and from 6 to p.m. to 2 a.m., I'm working on that, right? And then also, it was like there were some people there that were really great, but there was also just this feeling that I just couldn't be my fullest self there, you know? And this is no knock to the organization, because I love that company. I love the founders who built it. But like, it was actually hard for me as a young 20-something, like, there weren't really any people that looked like me in leadership for real. You know, like I had a supervisor who I love to this day. Shout out my guy, Brian. Amazing. you know, but I always felt like outside of him, it was like, yo, like, this ain't my tribe. I can't really be my best. And if I can't really show up dressing how I want to dress, talking how I want to talk, I feel like I'm missing something that I could contribute. And it got to a point where over time, I'm like, yo, my real heart is in this thing that I want to build, that instead of making millionaires more millions, I can help the people around me go from zero to $60,000 a year using these strategies that I'm learning, you know, at that place. And that was why I ended up making the leap.
So for people that are like in situations like that, right? You're in corporate America, you're making some, you know, pretty decent money, right? Enough mm-hmm. to pay the bills, travel, do things that they, you know, you like to do in your leisure. How did you prepare financially to make a transition like that? Because that's not easy for a lot of folks to just drop a 9-to-5 that they, you know, want to get out of so bad, but they can't get over the thought of losing, you know, X amount of dollars and then going out and have to grind from scratch. Like, mm-hmm. I guess, how did you prepare yourself financially and mentally for that?
Yeah, so I prepared myself way more mentally than I did financially, I'll be honest. and that's one thing that I want to tell all the soon-to-be entrepreneurs out there, like, yo, like, ain't no shame in allowing that job to be your first investor. Ain't no shame in stacking your bread so you have 3 to 6 to 9 months of rent saved up, you know? I'll be honest, like, that was not my story, but if I had the opportunity to do so, I would have loved to, right? But for me, the financial preparation was, you know, at that time, I was in a relationship. We had a crib over in, like, Port Richmond, you know, little two-bedroom house. And when I knew I was about to make the leap, I had to give that up. You know what I'm saying? Like, I had to have some real conversations with my partner and be like, look, like, I'm about to make this sacrifice. And to do it, I know that I have to, you know, lower my expenses. So I ended up, like, finding this warehouse in North Philly, you know, that I knew I could get a room for $450 a month that then I would split with my boy Leonzo because he wanted to crash there too. So I'm paying $225 or $300 a month for rent as opposed to what I was paying. So I made real decisions to sacrifice a lot of the comfort that I had in my life at that time to make space for what I knew would help me have the freedom to actually build the business, knowing in the beginning it wasn't going to be, you know, generating a lot of income for me.
And you talked about that a lot in a lot of interviews that I've seen you do. When that you transition to that warehouse, right? So, you know, you leave your job, you leave the crib in Port Richmond, you go to the warehouse on 9th and Dolphin.
Yeah, in the mix, baby.
In the mix, right in the mix, heart of North Philadelphia. We out here. What was that like? So, like, you leave this job, you're no longer making income, you know, like a cushion income where not every 2 weeks you knew your paycheck was coming in. You know, how did you, like, think about that shift to allow you to, like, all right, I'm in this warehouse, I'm splitting this rent with Leonzo. How do I give myself, you know, how did you start to generate income during that time? Because you was, you know, chilling. You was chilling on the couch. Like, y'all was just there. Y'all just needed a space to be.
Exactly.
So what did that look like?
Yeah, so that's exactly right. Like, the space for us was, yo, I'm going to lower my expenses. This is going to be where I live. And everything I needed to do my creative work, I was going to have in that space. So I put up the backdrop for me. I was shooting music videos still at that time. You know, we built the studio for Zoe. But my way of making money at that time was through, yo, photo shoots, music videos, you know, figuring out how I could get an artist to give me $250 for a music video, and then eventually $400, and then eventually $500. And that's how I was doing it, you know? And for me, the value in that was, one, this is a way I can make money, even though ultimately I want to build this other business. But two, it was a way I could make money but still stay close to the environment I wanted to be at, which was around creative people, you know, and really just, like, in the atmosphere, you know? Because, you know, the thing about when you work a different job is, like, there's a whole shift you have to make, right? Like, let's say I work in, I don't know, electrical engineering, you know, during the day, and then I come home and I'm doing something creative. You got to, like, shift the whole part of your brain to the other side, right? And sometimes that shift is draining, you know?
Yeah, no, that's true. That's hella true. So, I think that kind of leads us to this next part of the discussion here. Like, so you go, you're in this warehouse, you're in Leonzo crashing, you know, talk to us about what started to what was about to be birthed at that time, right? Because the light bulb went off somewhere in that time frame. Because it's like, yo, we gotta pay rent. We need bread coming in. This, we can't just be in here just like you know doing this. It gotta be something, some money we making from this. So when 100%. Did that light bulb go off for you?
Yeah. So that decision that I made to move into that warehouse was one of the best decisions I made in my life, and it was because it then did a couple things. But the biggest one is, again, I had everything I needed there. Right. I had my photo backdrop to make money, you know, with clients and create and just get my stuff off. Right. Like I had the couch where we were using as our co-working space. You feel me? And like we were having the conversations, you know, to program ourselves as entrepreneurs. Right. Reading the books, doing the YouTube deep dives, watching all the interviews, et cetera. And quickly, all of our friends who would come by to the space never wanted to leave. And what I had noticed was all of the things that I needed, which was access to my creative tools and, you know, access to the information for how to build a business and, you know, just the right like-minded people around me, like Leonzo at that time. We were both on the same mission, so, like, we could affirm each other. All those things I needed was exactly what the other thousands and thousands of creators in our city needed as well. And the reason I knew that is because my friends who would come to the space just to kick it, they never wanted to leave. So the light bulb came in a way of just being like, wait, why are we here? Oh, because we all need this. And what we all need is space and access to tools and access to a positive-minded community. And I said, all right, rent going to keep coming month after month. So if my homies could just pitch up on rent, then I could actually use that money to pay the rent and invest in new equipment, right? And we could really start to make this space a place where we can be and be more comfortable. And that was the impetus of what then later, a couple years later, became the actual membership program that Rec is built on today.
Right. So let's touch on that because we want to bring this story full circle. We want to bring it all the way up, right? So you go from, again, we're going to talk about come from very humble beginnings to raising capital for a new space, right? You built Rec at this warehouse at 9th and Dolphin. You guys kind of outgrew that space, right? Yep. And you needed something that was a lot more fitting to how you wanted to grow the brand, right? Mm-hmm. Can you talk about like when you went into like negotiations and you guys first sat down, was like, yo, we need to raise bread and like, you know, what did that look like? Because you had never done that before, right?
Right.
And you now had to do this at a high level. You had investors coming in, you know, investing money. They're not donating anything.
It wasn't donating.
I stand corrected. So talk to us about that because I think that's important to know. Like this dude from G-Town, right? Yeah. Come from, you know, very humble beginnings, as we said, right? If you listen to the story in the beginning, you'll hear about it, right?
Yep.
To raising bread, like, talk to us about that. Like,
yeah, man, and I think the one part that is important for people to take away from the story to this point right now is the beauty is I got to solve my own problem first, right? Like, taking that leap to move into the warehouse was me taking a stab at finding the solution to my own problem. And then once I did that, I realized that same solution was extremely valuable to the people I cared about, which was other creatives, right? But yeah, eventually it got to the point where, like, we had a few hundred members come into that warehouse, right? And like, it was like, yo, man, we thugging it out. People climbing up four flights of stairs to get here. We ain't got no heat. We ain't got no AC. And it was clear that people needed what we had and it was time to grow. So when we first started fundraising, you know, the only experience we had raising money to that point was a Kickstarter campaign that we had did before that failed, right? So like, we had no real fundraising experience that we could actually pull from. And in the beginning, it's hard because it's like, yo, like we have what most people start out with, which is like the friends and family round. You go to your wealthy family members and friends and they give you the cash to start your business. Me and my co-founder, Dave, didn't have that. So it was, nope, what's next? So I then just went into the camp on YouTube of just YouTube University, man, and started to just look up, you know, and just started to do a ton of research about what fundraising was about. And what I ultimately learned is really two things. One, people don't admit how much emotions are at the core of our financial decisions, you know? So like, for example, like the first time I was trying to raise money, again, I'm still sleeping in the warehouse at this time. I'm trying to make ends meet, and I didn't have a lot of bread, so like I'm like, okay, cool, how I'm eating, you know? But then I'd walk into a room, and then I have to have the confidence to ask some dude that I didn't know very well for $1 million, right? The emotional turmoil of that alone is crazy, especially if you've never had $1 million. Like, so I would show up putting all the value on the other side of the table, like, so glad that you made time today. Thank you for being here. Would love for you to hear what we have to talk about our business. Yeah, like, you know what I mean? And I was showing up not confident, so everyone was turning us down, right? For other reasons too, but like a lot of it was that. So I had to learn about like, what are the stories I've been making up about money and the value of the business versus my personal value as a founder, right? And I had to really do that work and get to the core of it to be able to show up with the confidence of, hey, I'm really glad that we could make time for this. Hey, this is what I'm doing, and I want to invite you to be a part of it, right? Because at the end of the day, like, these are winners, right? These are people who have made a living in a really, they've accomplished a lot of stuff. And winners only want to invest in other winners. So if I couldn't even get to that emotional space where I really had belief in what I was doing, that I deserved the money, that I was going to put that money to good use, and that I was actually doing them the favor, because all they had is the money, but I've got the vision and the business and the data to prove that hundreds of people have been paying for this every month, it was like, wait, I'm the one who's providing the value here. And once that story started to shift, that energy started to shift, then we started to get the yeses. So, you know, that's kind of what my first, you know, fundraising experience was. It was a lot of those no's and dealing with all the rejection of 50, 60, 70 people saying no, you know, before we ended up getting our first yes. But then fortunately, after we got that first yes and we really started to dial in the story, then we were off to the races. And then ultimately, we was able to pull together about $3.5 million. To make our project happen.
That's prolific, bro. Like,
thank you, bro.
Humble beginnings. Again, I'm gonna keep bringing this up because I think it's important to let people know it's not, you know, I mean, the cliche statement is not where you're starting, you know, is where you're going. You know, there's a lot of other cliche statements that we can put out there, but like your story is the testament that you, hey, where you are today or where you were, it's not where you're headed and not where you're going to be. Like, you probably never imagined, you know, growing up in Germantown, that you would ever probably be at a table, you know, early on, right? You, you know, once you got to college and high school, you know, you started, your mind started shifting. You got that exposure. Yeah. You knew you were going to be successful.
Yeah.
But early on, nobody could tell you, yo, you're going to be at a table negotiating, you know, terms for funding. Like, that's next level, man. So I appreciate you for sharing that with people. So before we wrap up the interview here, man, I got two questions that I have to ask you.
Yeah.
At any point throughout your life, right, did you ever come to believe that desiring money ever made you a bad person?
Yo, I love that question. Yo, because for us as people of color, man, I think a lot of us early on believe that. You know, like when you coming up, bro, and you ain't got no money, all the people you love, right, around you that's decades older than you ain't got no money, and you know they've been working hard, right? You know they working 2 and 3 jobs and don't got no bread. The story we like to tell ourselves to almost feel better about our circumstances is that anyone who then does have a lot of money must have done something corrupt to get it, you know? And it's so, so, so important to unlearn that. I had to unlearn it myself, you know what I'm saying? Because what starts to happen is if you subconsciously believe that in your heart, that having a lot of money equals being a bad person, you're going to subconsciously run from money your whole life. So when opportunities present themselves, you're going to self-sabotage, you know what I'm saying? Like, you're going to, or even worse, not even want the money, because if you don't want the money, it feels good when you don't get it, right? When that's a whole survival tactic, right? But yeah, man, at one point in my life early on, I believed that, but I had to really quickly unlearn it if I wanted to then actually be successful.
Dope. And then my final question, man, this is so relevant and so on target, right? About 2 weeks ago, probably timeline a little off, you posted a picture of you and Kanye, right? You don't have to really describe too much of what was talked about. I know you want to, you know, you probably have your own way of wanting to release that.
Sure.
But I gotta ask, what was what's one lesson that all creators can learn from Kanye?
Yeah, that's a fire question. And look, man, I think the thing that I've most learned from Kanye, and even watching the documentary, right, that just dropped, it even affirmed this more. We can all learn the power of belief from Kanye. You know, like, again, like, that, even, you know, kind of similar to the last question you just asked, like, your belief systems create your reality in so many ways. So, like, the idea of a person who looks like us believing that they deserve and have the capability to make millions and millions, if not billions of dollars, is a radical idea already. And, you know, that power of belief is so real to me that, like, you know, my first tattoo I ever got right here and right here, it literally says, he who says he can and he who says he can't are both correct. And the thing about Kanye is, like, he and his mother Donda, like, Donda had so much belief in Kanye as a young person that, like, normalized Kanye feeling that he was the best producer in the game. Like, his mom was memorizing his raps even when they were still trash, right, and affirming that in him. And because of that, he had the confidence to tell us back then he was taking over the fashion industry. Before he even did it, he was, I'm taking over rapping. Before anyone respected him as a rapper. And he got to kind of speak those things into existence. But if he never believed in the beginning that he could, then his behavior and his actions and his habits would have never aligned to actually enable him to turn that vision into the tangible realities that we all can hear, see, and touch now. So what I think we should all learn from Kanye is the power of self-belief is where any great accomplishment comes from.
Mm. And on that note, folks, we're going to definitely drop the mic on that one, because that one right there was, that's some bars right there, man. So listen, we're going to wrap up this interview. Will, we appreciate you for joining the, you know, Breaking Bread show and giving our audience so much to take back and really, you know, soak in a lot of what you kind of described. But for those of them, for those of you out there that don't know Will, where can they find you? Like, you, I know you have a website. You on you on every social media platform. So tell them where to find you, bro.
Yeah, I'm out here. If you want to keep up with me and my journey, I go by The Will Toms, you know, all over the internet. So the website, thewilltoms.com. The Will, last name is Toms, T-O-M-S. Instagram at The Will Toms, Twitter at The Will Toms. And then also, you know, follow Rec Philly, you know, on Instagram.
Shout out to Rec.
We put out a lot of content. And the last thing I do want to say, though, before I get off here, man, I just want to also give you your flowers, bro. Like, this concept, you know, of just talking about money and normalizing these conversations is just so important, you know, to our culture and to our next generation that's coming up. So I just want to say thank you, because I know you're somebody that not only lives this through this media of this podcast, but behind the scenes are doing real things publicly and even in private to really push forward what you stand for, which is people like us normalizing having and talking about bread. So I just wanted to thank you, bro. Please keep doing this, and I'm excited to watch this platform grow.
Yeah, bro, I'll take that. That's all love, bro. I appreciate you, man.
You already know. Thanks for having me, bro.
Likewise.
Count it up, count it up, count it up, count it, count it up, count it up, count it up, count it, count it up, count it up, count it up, count it.